Let us pray. We're grateful to you, God, for our Bible study today, and we're thankful to you for your children who make it a point of duty to be here every time we study the Bible together. We're praying, Lord, that the blessing of studying the Word will come upon every believer here in Jesus' name. And also as hearing this through cassette, Lord, we're praying you grant them the same concentration, attention, and love that you grant us here. And we pray, O Lord, that the same blessing you are giving unto us, you give unto them in Jesus' name. Wake us up tonight. Enlighten us tonight. Show us the way tonight. That, Lord, what you are speaking to us will make a definite impact on every life, and you turn us around to walk in the right direction as we move on to the heavenly city in Jesus' name. Open our eyes of understanding that we may see and behold wonderful things out of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. I welcome every one of you to our Bible study tonight. You know that I appreciate your coming. And this is an important book of the Bible, the last book of the Bible. It's the book of the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ to his own children, to his own saints, to the church, through the Apostle John, and it was signified by the hand of an angel. And because of that word, signified by the word, by the hand of an angel, that word signified means that it was symbolized. So you'll find a lot of symbols in the book of Revelation. We've studied Revelation chapter 1 already, and we've seen the vision of the glorified Christ. One of the things that the Lord told John to do after he saw the vision is that he gave him a duty, a responsibility, an assignment. That assignment is write this down. And the Lord told him what to write. If you look at chapter 1, verse 19, write the things which thou hast seen, part 1. And then in part 2, and the things which are. Now in part 3, and the things which shall be hereafter. The Lord himself divided the book of Revelation into three parts. Part 1 is what we have studied. The things that you have seen. The glory of Christ. The splendor of Christ. The majesty of Christ. The dominion of Christ. The appearance of Christ has appeared from glory unto John in the Isle of Patmos. That's part 1. But then he told him to write part 2. The things which are. What are those things? The things concerning the church. That's what you'll find in chapters 2 and 3. You'll find in chapters 2 and 3 the message of the Lord unto the church. Unto the church of this and of that and of that. Right. And then he gave the message. And he gave the message describing the condition of every church and the state of every church and the spiritual standing of every church. And all that you read in chapters 2 and 3, they are the message of the Lord, the bridegroom, the head of the church, the cornerstone in the church to the people of God, not only at that time, but all through the church age until the Lord will come. And then you see in part 3, as we look at that verse 19, and the things which shall be hereafter. What does that mean hereafter? It means after the church age, after the church had been raptured, after the church had been taken away. That will be the part 3. And you're going to write all about that too. And that you write after I had written the things that are. The things concerning the church. And you'll find that in chapters 4 and 5. And then chapter 6. All through to 19. Then chapters 20 to 22. You'll find in chapter 4. After the church had been taken away from the earth. We find the church around the throne of God. Worshipping the Lord, glorifying the Lord. You find that in chapters 4 and 5. As they sing unto the Lord, glory and honor, majesty, dominion be unto you, because thou wast slain, and you have redeemed us out of the earth. And then you find from chapter 6, the great tribulation. While the people of God have been raptured, the redeemed of the Lord, they are already in heaven in fellowship and worship of the Lord Almighty. Then there will be the great tribulation on the earth here. That ends in chapter 19. And then in chapter 19, you find the bride of Christ, and you find the marriage supper of the Lamb. And then in chapter 20, you find the devil is bound and is thrown into the bottomless pit, and you have the great white throne judgment. Chapters 21 and 22, the things that will be in the hereafter and after and after until eternity. That is the new Jerusalem, the new heavens and the new earth. We're back today to study the things concerning the church, the things that are.
As you look at these churches, these two chapters, let me just give you a broad overview to start with. There are three things we're going to do here. Number one, you have a primary association. As the Lord wrote to the church through the pen of John, the beloved, you find in chapter 1, verse 11, and saying, I'm Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. What thou seest, write in a book. Send it to the seven churches which are in Asia. I've told you already, and you see it in the Bible yourself, that this book of Revelation is symbolic. There are some things, some materials there that are symbolic, and there are some numbers there that are symbolic. And the number 7 here, I've told you many, many times, is the number for fullness, for completeness, for perfection, for finality, and for totality. And so when it says, you write to the 7 churches in Asia, it's saying, this is the message for the whole church, for the fullness and the completeness of the church, for the whole church in all the various ages until the end of time. Then he mentions the churches unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. Those are the churches. As you look at those 7 churches, representative of all the churches of all the ages, until Christ will come and take the church away. There are 3 things to see. Number 1, there is a primary association. Number 2, there is a personal application. Number 3, there is a prophetic anticipation. Number 1, there is a primary association. That means the message was sent to those churches, and the primary association, the first recipient of the word, the first recipient of the message, Ephesus, primary association with Ephesus, all the things they said there. But then it's not only a primary association, there is a personal application. That's why you'll find that in every church, when he gives a message, he ends every message by saying, he that has an ear to hear. That's an individual. And that's a universal thing. And it's not just in Ephesus, and it's not just in Smyrna, and it's not just in Pergamos. Anyone, anywhere. As you read this one, he that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. That is, the message is not a limited message. It's not something that is limited to Ephesus or Smyrna or Pergamos or Thyatira or Sardis or Laodicea or Philadelphia. It's reaching to everyone. There is a personal application. Number 3, there is a prophetic anticipation. You'll find us read all these letters. In fact, Jesus Christ said, there's prophecy here. I will come to you quickly. That means it's future. That means it's looking forward. And he talks to the church in Smyrna, and he says, don't fear that thing you are going to suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison 10 days, and you'll suffer for a while. But be faithful unto the end. I'm going to give you a crown of glory. And that's still future. And when he talks to the other churches, he says the same thing, what you have. Hold it fast until I come, because I am coming. And when I come, I'm going to reward everyone according to his works. So then you will find that as you read all these letters and epistles and messages to the churches, you'll find the prophetic anticipation. The prophecy is making us look forward to anticipate and to prepare for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now you'll find here, look at this, in Revelation chapter 2 verse 1. And unto the angel of the church in Ephesus write. When you go to verse 8, and to the angel of the church in Smyrna write. And then you come to chapter verse 12, it says, and to the angel of the church in Pergamos write. You come to the latter part of the chapter, and he's still saying the same thing. He's telling us in verse 18, unto the angel of the church in Thyatira, write, in chapter 3, verse 1, and to the angel of the church in Sardis, write. And then he comes to verse 7, unto the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write, verse 14, unto the angel of the church in Laodicea, write. So then you understand that the message was being sent to the angel of the church in every place. When he says the angel of the church, angel of the church, what does that mean? Because you know that many people, when they read about angels, the only reference they have to angel is that angels are up in heaven. And when it says to the angel of the church in Ephesus and Smyrna and all those places, right, Who was just John writing to? Was he writing to an angel in heaven? The answer is no. Could you post a letter to an angel in heaven? It was writing to the leadership of every church, and was writing to those leaders, and they're just saying, this is the message I have for the church. But you see, they are called angels. That's right. Turn your Bible to 2 Samuel chapter 14. 2 Samuel chapter 14. I'm reading to you there from verse 17. It says, Then thine handmaid said, the word of my lord the king shall now be comfortable. For as an angel of God, so is my lord the king. As an angel of the Lord, so is my Lord the King to discern good and bad. Therefore, the Lord thy God will be with thee. You see here, the woman was talking to David. And he was referring to David, and I said, yes, we know the wisdom you have, the discernment you have, and the knowledge you have. You are like an angel of the Lord. Go back down to verse 20. To fetch about this form of speech, as thy servant Joab done this sin, and my Lord is wise according to the wisdom of an angel of God to know all things that are done in the earth. So you understand then when it says to the angel of the church in Ephesus, right? It was talking to the leader there, because the leader in Israel was referred to as an angel of the Lord. Look, go to chapter 19 of that 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter 19. And look at verse 27. It says here, and he has slandered thy servant unto my Lord the King. But my Lord the King is as an angel of God. Do therefore what is good in thine eyes. Here is another individual calling David, referring to David, that he had the wisdom and the knowledge and the discernment of an angel of the Lord. You go back to 1 Samuel chapter 29. Again, you will discover here that when you refer to an angel, and you are referring to that angel in ministry on earth here, angel in ministry in the midst of the people of God, you are referring to somebody that is in leadership position. In chapter 29, verse 9, 1 Samuel, and Achish answered and said to David, I know that thou art good in my sight as an angel of God. And so you understand what the Lord is telling us. He's telling us that when you're a leader over the people of God, the Lord wants you to be like an angel, behave like an angel, act like an angel, be obedient like an angel. That's why it's referring to the leadership, or to the pastors and the teachers and the leaders in the church in that was writing to. It was referring to them as the angel of the Lord. In Zechariah chapter 12, verse 8. Zechariah chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 8. In that day shall the Lord defend the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and he shall be as David, and he that is feeble among them shall be as David, and the house of David shall be as God, as the angel of the Lord before them. He's saying that the time will come when the grace of God will be so abundant that the feeble among the people of God will be like David, and then the rest of the people will be like the angel of the Lord. And so when you read in these passages that we're reading, that you're writing to the angel of the church, you're actually writing to the people. It's just like in the Old Testament. Does the Bible say anything in the New Testament concerning these likeness or disappearance of the children of God, of the people of God, as angels? In Acts of the Apostles chapter 6. Acts of the Apostles chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 8. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. In verse 10, and they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. In verse 15, and all that sat in the council, looking steadfastly on him, saw his face as it had been the face of an angel. And so you find then, as you look at the letters and the epistles and the message that Jesus Christ sent through John, and he sent it to these various churches, in particular the church in Ephesus today, when it says, unto the angel of the church in Ephesus, right, was referring actually to the leader there. Now, Ephesus. This church in Ephesus, it was a wonderful church at the beginning, because here is where Paul the Apostle spent about 2 years. And before that time, Aquila and Priscilla had been ministering in that church. And Apollo, the most fervent and the most eloquent and the most logical and the most convincing in the early church, preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, that Apollos had a ministry in Ephesus as well. And then after that, Timothy had been sent to the church to pastor that church. And of late, we're told in history, at about 40 years to 50 years, John the Beloved had been pastoring the church in Ephesus. And it was actually while he was ministering as apostle, as teacher, as pastor and prophet in that church, was he taken by Domitian the emperor. And then he was banished unto the Isle of Patmos. And it was from there he received this revelation that the Lord gave unto him to the various churches. Now we look at the message to the church in Ephesus today. We're looking at Revelation chapter 2. Please open your Bible. We're reading from verse 1. Revelation chapter 2 from verse 1. And unto the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these things says he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear with them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say the apostles are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do thy first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove the candlestick out of its place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which are also I hate. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. As we look at this message today, the title of the message is First Love with Sound Doctrine in the Church. If there is anything the Lord Jesus Christ appreciates in his church, he wants truth established in his church, because he is the way and the truth and the life. And because his truth personified, he wants truth, sound doctrine in the church of the living God. You also understand that what motivated him to die on the cross is the love of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins. And he has made us priests and kings unto God the Father in heaven. It was love. And because of that, he wants love in the church. The first love, the fervent love, the undying love, the unending love, the unparalleled love, the kind of love he wants in his church. And we're going to divide the message into three parts. Number one, the description and declaration of Christ the Lord. The description and declaration of Christ the Lord. And then point number two, dedication and discernment with consistent labor. Dedication and discernment with consistent labor. And then number three, the decline and demand for love, for Christ-like love. We come back to point number one, the description and the declaration of Christ the Lord. Please come back to Revelation chapter 2. We're looking at verse 1. Revelation chapter 2, verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write. It was the Lord talking, because it says, these things says he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, and who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Here we find that in each of the seven letters that Jesus Christ wrote to the churches, he first of all described himself. because he had to have the credential, he had to have the authority. And because of that credential authority, that's why he first of all described himself. And the description was not coming as a surprise, a strange thing to John the beloved. You know why? Because he had seen the vision of the glorified Christ on the Isle of Patmos. That's in chapter 1. And you'll find that all the selections of the attributes and the characteristics and the postures and the portrait of Jesus Christ in each of the letters, it's taken from chapter 1. Here it says that he is the one that pulled the seven stars in his right hand and is walking in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. That's exactly what John the Beloved had seen in chapter 1. Because when he had this vision, please turn back to chapter 1. And we're looking at it from verse 10. I was in the spirits on the Lord's day. And I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. And then that voice was saying something. The voice was describing himself. It says, I'm Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And then when he had heard that, that was a surprise to him. Here he was in the Isle of Patmos, and the Alpha and the Omega, the Almighty and the Great One, the Supernatural One, and the one that has dominion over all the earth, the first and the last, was talking to him. And then it says in verse 12, and I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks, and in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about with paps and with a golden girdle. That's exactly what the Lord is repeating here. The Lord, as he describes himself to the church in Ephesus, he said, this is who I am. I am that one that holds the seven stars in my right hand, and I'm walking in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. The description and the declaration of Christ the Lord. As you look at verse 20, it says, the mystery, the hidden knowledge of the seven stars, which thou sawest in my right hand. And it says, and the seven golden candlesticks, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Now, when you read this, you need to understand, because there are many people that may just read through the book of Revelation and they don't have a clue as to what the Lord is saying. First of all, let me point out this to you. These things says he that holdeth the seven stars. And when it mentions the stars, what are you thinking about? You might be thinking that, well, Jesus Christ, the Son of God and the King of Glory, is holding the stars in heaven, and he's holding them in his hand. Please remember once again that the book of Revelation is symbolic. And when it mentions star, you need to be finding out, what is this? What is this star? It's Jesus Christ himself. Look at the description of Jesus Christ in Revelation chapter 22 and verse 16. Revelation chapter 22 verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning. What's that? Star. Jesus Christ himself is referred to as a bright and the morning star. And he is a person. He is God. He is the Son of God. He is Jesus. He is our Savior, the Redeemer. He is referred to as the greatest of all stars, the bright and the morning star. When he says, then I hold the stars in my hand, you need to understand, what are those stars? Who are those stars? Actually, that wasn't a strange language to the people that remember their Bible history very well. Please turn to Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37, I'm reading to you from verse 9. And he dreamed yet another dream, and told it his brethren, and said, behold, I have a dream. I've dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. Here is Joseph. And you know that there are 12 sons. And he said, the rest of the children, 11 sons, those are the patriarchs. Those are the leaders of each of the tribes of Israel. He said, all those 11 stars and the sun and the moon, they made obeisance to me. And he told it in verse 10, he told it to his father and to his brethren. And his father rebuked him and said unto him, listen to this, what is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I, the sun, and thy mother, the moon, and thy brethren, the stars, indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee, to the earth? You can see as far back as Genesis that the leadership of the people of each of the tribes of the children of Israel, they were referred to as stars. And in fact, when you come to almost the last book of the Bible, that is the last but one in Jude, you'll find that the people that are not preaching right, and they're moving from one place to the other, and they're preaching false doctrine. See the way they are described in Jude. I'm reading from verse 11. Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, and ran greedily after the heir of Balaam for reward, and perished in the gainsaying of Korah. These are spots in your feasts of charity, when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Clouds are they without water, carried about with winds. Trees whose fruit withereth, without fruit, twice dead, plucked up by the roots. Raging waves of the sea, forming out their own shame. Wandering stars. You see that? Those false prophets, wandering stars. Those people that were going about, roaming from one house to house, from one place to the other, and they were preaching something wrong, and they were foaming out their shame. They are called wandering stars, to whom is reserved the blackness of the darkness forever. So then when it says the stars, it's referring to the people of God who are leading others, the workers, the leaders, the pastors, the preachers, who are leading others in the way of the Lord. Well, you understand, as the stars shine, so should the believers, especially the ministers of the gospel, so should we shine. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. That's why they are referred to as stars. Come back to Revelation chapter 2. I'm reading to you from verse 1. Unto the angel of the church in Ephesus, right? This thing says, he that holdeth the 7 stars. Again, 7 is the number for completeness. All the stars, all the pastors, all the leaders, all the people that are leading others in this journey to life eternal. I'm holding the 7 stars in my right hand, who walketh in the midst of the 7 golden candlesticks. Now, I mentioned golden candlesticks. Those are the lampstands. That is, the lampstands that bear the light. And he already explains to us what that is. If you go back to Revelation chapter 1 and in verse 20, the mystery of the 7 stars, which thou sawest in my right hand, and the 7 golden candlesticks, what are they? The 7 stars are the angels of the 7 churches, are the leaders of the 7 churches, are the preachers in the 7 churches, are those apostles and leaders in the 7 churches. And the 7 candlesticks, the 7 lampstands, and the 7 materials and equipment bearing the light that thou sawest, those are the 7 churches. The lampstands, the candlesticks are the 7 churches. Why are they golden? Because they are precious. Why are they golden? Because they are pure. Why are they golden? Because they should be incorruptible. Why are they golden? Because they are bought at a very great price unto the Lord, the church of the living God, selected and chosen and set apart for the glory of God, to beam out, to shine forth the light of the gospel. And let's look at Matthew chapter 18 and see the fulfillment of the promise of the Lord, because he says, well, you will find me, even though I'm risen from the dead and ascended on high, the position and the place you will find me will be the position where I'm taking care of all the churches. Matthew chapter 18, I'm reading to you from verse 20. For where 2 or 3 are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. And where do we find him? He that holdeth the 7 stars, and who walketh in the midst of the 7 golden candlesticks. That's exactly what he had said. You'll find me in the midst of my people that are shining forth the glory and the light of the gospel. In Matthew chapter 28, reading from verse 18, Jesus came and he spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, here is the position you'll find me. I'll be with you. I am with you, even to the end of the world. And you find then that the Lord Jesus Christ is faithful and true to his own promise. He says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will be with you. You'll find me in the midst of the churches, in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. And when he's in our midst, it's not just there. It's not just looking. It's very busy. It's watching over us and it's doing something wonderful, exactly what we need for him to do to strengthen us for the task that we need in our ministry. In Psalm 18 verse 35, thou hast also given me the shield of thy salvation and the right hand, and thy right hand holdeth me up, and thy gentleness has made me great. Says, I'm holding the seven stars. I'm holding all the leaders. I'm holding the preachers and the pastors. And because he's holding us, he holds us up. He's lifting us up. He's sustaining us. He's supporting us so that we will not fall. And his gentleness, his gentle grip on us has made us great. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 41. And see, as the Lord fulfills this promise in your life, and see the effect and the consequence when you are held by the right hand of majesty on high. Isaiah chapter 41, I'm reading from verse 13. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. And that gives assurance to preachers. It gives assurance to pastors. It gives assurance to those people that have been saved and sanctified and spirit-filled and appointed and anointed and chosen and ordained by the Lord to do something significant in the church of the living God. The Lord is saying, I'm going to be with you. I've assigned you, appointed you to do what you're doing. And because of that, I'm not going to disappoint you or leave you alone. I'll be with you till the very end. I, the Lord God, will hold your right hand, saying unto you, fear not, I will help you. Fear not him. Verse 14, thou warm Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help you, says the Lord, and thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Behold, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument, having teeth. Thou shalt thresh the mountains and beat them small, and shall make the hills as chaff. Thou shalt fan them, and the wind shall carry them away, and the wild wind shall scatter them. And thou shalt rejoice in the Lord, and shall glory in the Holy One of Israel. That tells us then, the ministry of the Lord, what he does for us. You look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, and you see once again that if you will do your part, come out from among them, be you separate, says the Lord. If you're obedient to the Lord, and then you come to serve him the way he wants you to serve him, you'll find him fulfilling his promise. It tells us in 2 Corinthians 6 from verse 16, all through to the beginning of chapter 7, it says, on what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them. Not stay with them. If you're a minister, make yourself distinctive. If you're a child of God, make yourself distinctive. Come out from among them. You're coming out of the world. You're coming out of sin. You're coming out of every pollution and every perversion that's there in the world. You're not joining them in their habits, in their character, in their misdeeds, in their misdemeanor. You're walking according to the word of the Lord. Wherefore, come out from among them. That's a call to holiness. That's a call to purity. That's a call to sanctification. That's a call to righteousness. Because you remember now, it says unto the angel of the church in Ephesus. That means then, as angels are high, you have a high calling. As angels are heavenly, you have a heavenly calling. As angels are holy, you have a holy calling. And because of that height, and because of that holiness, and because of that heavenliness, that's why he says, come out from among them, and be ye separate, says the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you. And ye shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, chapter 7, verse 1, let us cleanse ourselves from all the filthiness of the flesh and the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. And that's what the Lord is telling us. He's saying that if we will be obedient to him, then he will honor us. And his presence will be with us in John chapter 14, verse 23. John 14, verse 23. Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him, and will make our abode with him. Come back to Revelation chapter 2, and you see in that verse 1, you see the fulfillment of the promise of God. It says, what I said I will do, I'm doing. Where I said I will be, I am there. I said I will help my people, I will hold them up, and they will not fall because I'm sustaining them with my grace. And that's exactly what I'm doing. Therefore, John, write unto them, especially now to the angel of the church in Ephesus, this is what you are going to write. These things says he that holdeth the seven stars, you know them now, in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. And now, when he says he's walking in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, what's he doing there? Number one, he's there to examine and to evaluate. That's why he says, I know your works. And he tells every church, I know your works. I'm examining you. I'm evaluating you. Number two, to correct and to encourage. He corrected all these churches where there are some things to reprove and some things to change and some things to turn around and some things to transform and the work to be done better. He corrected them and then he encouraged them. Number three is to deliver them and defend them in times of danger. That's why he says, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. And there is nothing for you to fear. Nothing in the air. Nothing in the sky. Nothing in the sea. Nothing on earth. Nothing coming from the village or coming from the city. There is nothing to fear because the Lord Jesus Christ, the head of the church, the captain and the conqueror, is with you and is to deliver you and to defend you in the times of danger. And then number four is to trim our lives and to pour in oil of grace into our vessels, into our vessels. And then number five is to prune and to purge the believers, the children of God, for more fruitfulness. With Christ, the mighty conqueror, the mighty Christ, the mighty captain, the one that never lost any battle, so close to us, we can be strong and we can be faithful at all times. And I pray that the grace of God will be more abundant in your life. You'll be faithful to the Lord in Jesus' name. We come to point number two, dedication and discernment with consistent labor. Dedication and discernment with consistent labor. Here we come to Revelation chapter 2. I'm reading to you from verse 2. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear with them which are evil, and hast tried them. Thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and has found them liars. Here we find this church, and what has this church been doing? They have been laboring for the Lord. They have been working for the Lord. And they have been up and down, exactly as what Jesus said, get occupied till I come. Occupy till I come. He's giving us grace. He's giving us talent. He's giving us skill. And he's giving us assignment. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And then when they have been born again, you baptize them in water in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. After you've done that, integrate them with the church, teaching them all things whatsoever I have commanded you. On that condition, on that basis, I will be with you until the end of the world. That's exactly what they were doing. But there were some other people that wanted to join them. They wanted to join the workforce, and they say, we're apostles too. They didn't just say, yes, come on board and join us and do the work with us. They tested them. They tried them. They examined them. They interviewed them. And they saw that they were liars. And because they saw they were liars, they will not allow them to have part in the ministry. And then it says in verse 3, it says, and has borne, and has patience, and for my name's sake has labored, and has not fainted. It said, these people in Ephesus, they labored for the Lord. See their dedication, see their devotion, and see the discernment, and see the consistent labor with which they were serving the Lord. And it says in verse 6, but this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which also I hate. These people were very sound doctrinally. Christ, the head of the church, commended this church for the works that they were doing. Number one, for their labor. Number two, for their patience. Number three, for their perseverance. Number four, for their forbearance. And then number five, for their discernment. Number six, for their firm and compromising stand for the doctrines of the word of God. The minister must work selflessly. the preacher, the pastor. You are not to live on a bed of roses. There are some people that are not expending their energy, and they are not laboring to the point of exhaustion. And they're so lazy and they're so idle, and they're taking care of themselves. They're too self-conscious. But the Lord is commending this church in Ephesus, because the angel of the church, the leader of the church, the pastor in that church, he labored to the point of exhaustion. And of course, like pastor, like the people, if the pastor is willing to bleed so that others may be blessed, the members of the church too, they'll be willing to bleed that others may be blessed. Their patience is mentioned two times. Because on the one hand, there is patience in service. On the other hand, there is patience in suffering. Whatever they were suffering, the persecution, the misunderstanding, and the conflict that came along with their labor, they bore that patiently. They accepted suffering and hardship as they patiently waited for their rewards in glory. This church was commended, because they labored not for the meat that perisheth, but for that which endures unto life eternal. And you think about many churches today, and you think about their activities, you think about their labor, and you think about their service, and you'll find that many of the things that many churches are laboring on or laboring for, they are the things that perish. And you should be asking yourself, if I have this blessing that this church is talking about, if I labor all my life the way this church is telling us to labor, what will be the reward of it 100 years from now? What will be the impact of it 100 years from now? What will be the influence of it in my life, in my family, in generations to come, in 100 years from now? That's the reason why this church, they labored. And the kind of labor they had, it was something commendable by the Lord of the church himself. Don't let us labor for the things that perish, but let us labor for the things that will endure to life eternal. Neither weariness nor personal problems could stop their labor of saving souls and maturing the saints in our labor to prepare a holy church, a sanctified church for Christ's second coming. We must refuse to give up, and we must maintain a forward drive. Be passionate about it. Be enthused about it, so that there's enthusiasm in you. There's zeal in you. Don't manifest tiredness and weariness and lukewarmness and passivity when you come to the house of the Lord. And when you're doing something for the Lord, get all your energy and all your force and everything you have into it, and be passionate so you have a forward drive. This church, that is the church of Ephesus, was characterized by scriptural discernment. They observed and they tried, they examined and they interviewed the professing apostles, and they found them to be deceitful and evil. Of course, they resisted them. They rejected those false apostles and false prophets and deceitful workers, because they were spreading false doctrine hated by Christ. Christ hated those doctrines of the Nicolaitans, and they hated those doctrines of the Nicolaitans too. What a wonderful thing. Well, it wasn't only the church of Ephesus in the New Testament that actually labored. You find the church in Thessalonica, for example. In 1 Thessalonica chapter 1, verse 3, you find a description of the faithfulness of this church, and the labor of this church, and the patience of this church, and the hope of this church. Look at it in, we're looking at it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, and in verse 3, it says, remembering without ceasing your walk of faith, and your labor of love, and your patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, in the sight of God and our Father. And if it was possible for the church in Ephesus, it should be possible for you. If it was the central thing, the major thing, the appreciated thing, the honored thing in the church of the Thessalonians, it should be the appreciated, honored, glorified thing in our lives too. Number one is the work of faith. You are believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you are working to bring others to the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. You want them to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ so they can be saved. And it's a labor of love. You're not doing it because somebody is compelling you, or somebody is driving you, or the pastor, or the preacher in the church, the leader in the church, is the one that is imposing that responsibility on you. You're doing it out of your heart, out of the depth of your heart, because of the love of God for you, and because of the hope that you have in the Lord, that the Lord is coming, a glorious hope, a wonderful hope. And because you know the Lord is coming, you have this patience of hope. And it's in the Lord our God and in the Lord Jesus Christ. The same labor you will find in the church of the Hebrews. You find in Hebrews chapter 6, reading from verse 10. Hebrews chapter 6, from verse 10, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. Please understand, it has to be of love. If it is not of love, it's nothing in the sight of the Lord. Anything you're doing for the kingdom of God, it must be out of the genuine love you have for God, and the love you have for the people of God, and the love you have for the sinners, so they will not perish. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which ye have showed toward his name, in that ye have ministered to the saints, and you still do minister, in verse 11, and we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end, that ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Don't be tired, and don't be indolent now, and don't give up now. Just keep on laboring, and let it be the labor of love. It means you are doing it without fainting. It means you are, in fact, that's what it says about the church of Ephesus. It said, you have labored and you have not fainted. Oh, you see, they have not fainted. What made them that they were not fainting, even though it appeared the load was heavy and the responsibilities were great, and it appeared that it was more than what natural people, physical people, and people without grace, they cannot bear. But these people were bearing it, and they were laboring, and they were not fainting. Why were they not fainting? I'll tell you. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, reading from verse 1, and then we jump down to verse 16. In chapter 4, verse 1, therefore, seeing we have this ministry, and as we have received mercy, we faint not. We faint not. What ministry have you received? Are you laboring and to the point of exhaustion, and yet you are not fainting? Are you laboring to the point where you're almost dropping down, almost physically drained, and there's no energy anymore, and yet in your spirit, in your emotion, in your heart, in your mind, you are not fainting? Why are you not fainting? Verse 16, for which cause we faint not, for though our outward man perish, and we're getting physically weak, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. How? For our little affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at things which are seen. That's why we don't faint. That's why we're not fainting. We do not look at the negative things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, the invisible things in glory, the promises of God, and the crown we shall wear, and the reward that will be given unto us, for the things which are seen are temporal, and but the things which are not seen are eternal. That's why this church continued to labor, and they were not fainting. As you read that, you must remember the life and the ministry and the labor of Paul the Apostle. And you will see that he labored in the same way. We're looking at chapter 20 of Acts of the Apostles, verse 17. Acts chapter 20, verse 17. And from Miletus he sent to Ephesus, and he called the elders of the church. That is, he was calling the elders of the church in Ephesus. And what was he telling them? He told them a number of things, but look at this now. I'm looking at it from verse 25. But now, behold, I know that ye all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. Wherefore, I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. Why? Because I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Paul the Apostle, he preached the sound doctrine, and he preached the fullness of the counsel of God. He had not been negligent in declaring to them the whole counsel of God. Here is the counseling and the commandment, the commitment he had for them in verse 28. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flocks. And this is the reason why whenever anybody came to the church in Ephesus, they will test him, they'll examine him, they will interview him, they will know whether he's for real or not, because Paul the Apostle, many years before, he had told them that after he had gone, and now he was gone, at the time John the Beloved was writing on the Isle of Patmos, Paul the Apostle had finished his work and he had gone to his reward. And now some apostles will come, deceitful workers, pretending to be the people of God, but the people, according to the word of Paul the Apostle, they examined them and they rejected them because they were not for real. For I know this, in verse 29, that after my departing shall grievous wolves entering in among you and not sparing the flock. Also of yourself shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. That is, Paul the apostle said, there are some people, they just want you for gain, they want you for money. And they will not go out there. If they really wanted to do evangelism, they will go to the sinners and do evangelism. But I'm telling you, Church of Ephesus, there are some people, they will come in among you. Even among yourselves, they will want to make a gain of you. Therefore, they separate themselves into a shed somewhere. And then they will come to some of you and brainwash you and distract your attention. And then confuse you. And say, you come, there's a new church, a new ministry here. Paul the apostle said, I'm warning you. Therefore, in verse 31, watch. And remember that by the space of 3 years, I cease not to warn every one of you night and day with tears. Now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified. And you will see this is the reason these people, they saw that these deceivers, when they came, they didn't receive them. Now, these deceivers, whenever they came, how did they present themselves? Paul the Apostle tells us, 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 13. It says, for such are false apostles. False apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. Are we surprised? And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. That's why the Lord has warned us over and over that we should beware of false prophets. We should beware when they come. They might talk sweet and they might talk nice and promise a lot of things. Nobody will tell you that he's a messenger of the devil. Nobody will say he's a false apostle. Nobody will come and tell you I'm a false prophet. No, they'll tell you they're the people of God. And they will tell you that they have this new ministry, this wonderful ministry, exalted ministry. And it's going to do something wonderful in your life. And if you are the one that is shopping, you are a religious shopper, you're going to market, it's like you're looking for this and looking for this and tasting here and tasting there, and you're not really a child in the family, and you're not a sheep in the fold, and you're not stable, you'll be hopping around like grasshoppers, and yet it's going to destroy you, because those people are very, very destructive. That's why we're warned in Romans chapter 16. Romans chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 17. Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. And do what? Tell me out loud. Avoid them, for they, in verse 18, for they that are such, serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the heart of the simple. In 2 John, verse 6, all through to verse 11, 2 John, I'm reading from verse 6, 2 John, verse 6, and this is love, that we walk after his commandments. This is the commandment, that as ye have heard from the beginning, ye shall walk in it. As you have heard from the beginning, since you have started coming here, the word of repentance, and the word of righteousness, and word of restitution, and the word of sanctification, and the word of one man, one wife, and the word of the second coming of the Lord, the word of the rapture before the tribulation, and the word that the Lord is telling us, without holiness no man shall see the Lord, that as you have heard from the beginning, ye should walk in it. Because many people will come to tell you that those are the olden days. Those are the times of the past. For many deceivers are entered into the world who confess not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Whosoever transgresses and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ, he has not God. Whosoever, anyone, a pastor, an apostle, a bishop, whatever they call themselves, if they do not abide in the doctrine of Christ, they do not have God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he has both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you, might be your relative, if there come any unto you, might be the person that brought you into this church long ago, many years ago, and you had profited spiritually from his preaching sometime many years ago, but now, if any come unto you and bring not this doctrine, sanctification is not important to him anymore. Humility is not important to him anymore. Submission to the will of God, to the word of God, is not important to him anymore. Heaven and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, is not important to him anymore. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed, for he that biddeth him Godspeed is a partaker of his evil deeds. And that's the challenge the Lord has given us, and that's the challenge that the church in Ephesus were living right to. We come back to Revelation chapter 2, and now we're looking at these two verses, verses 4 and 5. That although these people were holding on to some doctrine, there's something that happened in their midst, and this is the decline of love, and now the Lord was demanding they'll come back to Christ-like love. Point number 3, it's the decline of and the demand for Christ-like love. I'm reading to you from Revelation chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works. And then he tells them, if they do not do that, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. You need to understand that if there is anything that is very important, if there is anything that is very essential, it is love. Because in the mind of Christ is the bridegroom, and we are the bride. It's the husband, and we are the wife. If there is anything that should be central in the relationship between the bridegroom and the bride, it is love. Which husband will cheerfully accept the loss of the wife's first love? Will the wife feel happy about the relationship if the husband performed all the duties as usual, but expressly told her husband that he will not love the man anymore? Said, well, I'll cook your food, I'll wash your clothes, I'll do everything for you. The only thing is, I cannot give you my heart, I cannot give you my love. I will draw my love, but all the other things I will do. You husbands, will you accept? And which wife will accept if the husband will say, I'll do everything, I'll pay the school fees of the children, do everything you want me to do, everything I've been doing, I'll be very active, I'll be patient with you, I'll keep the house, I'll pay my rents, I'll do everything. The only thing is this, I'm not going to love you. No, you will not accept that. You will not be happy about that. You see this church in Ephesus, that's what they had done. And they were still active. They were still very busy. But then the love of God in their hearts, the first love, the fervency of that love, they had left behind. How serious a matter that is when the bride fails in love. To fail in love is to render all other activities unappreciated, unacceptable. Every other thing we do. If the fervent love is not there, if the love, the passionate love is not there for the Lord, it's gone. Then everything will be rejected. And the Lord was telling them that little by little, in the midst of the activities, because of the pressure of the activities they were having for the Lord, they had lost their first love. By the way, when you think of people losing their first love, how did they lose their love, first love? And you think about your life. When you first came to the Lord, when you were first born again, when you gave your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, what kind of love did you have at that time? And if you don't have that kind of passionate love now, fervent love now, overflowing love now, overwhelming love now for the Lord and for the church and for the people of God, how have you missed that? How have you missed it? One, many people lose their first love because of earthly business. They have so many things to do, and the cares of life pressing upon them, and so much to think about, and so much to do, that the fellowship with Christ is now crowded out. And the first love you had for the Lord is gone. Yes, you still come to church. Yes, you still read the Bible. Yes, maybe you're still witnessing. Maybe you're still holding to a position, and you're still preaching. That's what the church in Ephesus did. But they lost their first love. Activities crowded out the warm, fervent love of God. Number two, there are many people, so-called Christians, they lose their first love by setting their affections on things on the earth. They focus on material things, and they shift to material things, maybe pleasure or people. They just get interested in some other things. And because of that shift in interest and shift in focus, the first love is gone. Activities are still there. We come to Bible study. We come to church. We do everything. The only thing is, the first love is not there. Well, there are some other people, the reason they lose their first love is because of little acts of thoughtlessness. It happens in our families that you'll find that a man becomes careless towards his wife, just thoughtless. His language to her, his attitude to her, his expressions to her, his thoughtless habit to her, and the thing builds up until it's just, they're just like two tenants living together. There are some people that have done that to the Lord Jesus Christ, little acts of thoughtlessness. The way we relate to Christ, and the way we look at Christ, and the way we appreciate Christ, little acts of thoughtlessness, little omissions of our devotion that should feed love, the devotions we used to have, little things that will feed love and make love to increase and to grow, while meeting them, and little commissions of acts that kill love. There are some things we say that it will turn the other fellow away. It will just turn him away because those little things, they kill love. It's like the mosquitoes that can bite you and cause malaria and kill you eventually. And there are some people that have those little things, careless actions, careless omissions, and careless, they drop their conviction and their consecration and their vows, and eventually all those things they used to do, because the cold wind of temptation and what the association is blowing upon them, and it dampens their first love. Other people, it's because of repeated delayed obedience that the first love is gone. Don't you know our children at home, they have attachment to us, they love us very much, and then in their lives something begins to happen, repeated delayed obedience. You call them, and as you call that child, the child is hearing, and the child just says, I'm not going to answer, and just keep quiet. And you call and call, and the child is practicing and developing a habit of hardening his heart, hardening his conscience to the mother or to the father. Those little things, repeated delayed obedience, eventually will harden your heart, and you lose your first love. When you do not have, you are not conscious anymore to the promptings of the conscience by the Holy Spirit, eventually you are going to lose your first love. Other people, is because they entertain wrong notion about their faithfulness and steadfastness to sound doctrine. They feel that will replace the ardent, fervent love, affection they have for the Lord. And the real attachment to God's people, you see, it's like, since I'm doing my duty, I come at the right time, I do the right thing, I sing the song, I preach the message, and I walk the walk, and I talk the talk, and I'm doing all that, so what should anybody accuse me of? And I'm just there to do my duty, and since I'm there to do my duty, and that is all, I've done what I should do. How about the extra mile? Going the extra mile and waiting a little bit and putting another thing on top of it. Lord, I've done what you've told me to do. I love you so much. Is there still any other thing to do? There is still room yet, and I want to love you with all my heart. Is there any space in my heart that your love should still feel? When that is not there anymore, you see, sometimes the first love is gone. And then sometimes it's because of preoccupation with my personal need, preoccupation with my personal work, preoccupation with, here is a city, and to live in this city demands quite a lot. It needs money to live in a city like this. And then I become preoccupied with the work I will do, with the job I'm doing, with the company I've established, with the school I've set up, and with everything I'm doing. Because of that preoccupation with my own thing, I lose the love of God, the excitement I used to have, the enthusiasm I used to have, the passion I used to have, the fervency, the fire within me, the zeal I used to have. I lose everything, and the Lord is telling us, is saying, nevertheless, I have somewhat against you, because thou hast lost thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen. Here is the Lord challenging us, and is telling us there is something to remember. Remember the good old days when you loved the Lord without looking back, and you consecrated everything to the Lord without even thinking about the consequence. You loved the Lord. The unfortunate thing, or the sad thing for these people in Ephesus, is that as Paul the apostle had reached to the church in Ephesus, he had spoken to them about love every time, the love they ought to have, the love that God had for them, the love of Jesus Christ for them, the love of the husband to the wife, and the very fact they should be rooted and grounded in the love of God. And yet all that now they pushed behind, and they allowed their love to grow cold. In Matthew chapter 24, here is a prediction of the Lord Jesus Christ that near the time of his coming, there are the people that are going to lose their first love. Matthew 24 verse 12, And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. I pray you will endure to the end. I said you will endure to the end. The Lord is still reminding us in Matthew chapter 22 that the greatest of all the commandments is that you love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. In Matthew chapter 22 verse 37, Jesus saith unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. That is, there will be no rival, there will be no competition. You just pour your love on Christ. He loves you so much. So you pour your love on him. To him that loved us and lifted us, and to him that has washed us from our sins and now has made us kings and priests unto his Father, the God of heaven. This is the first commandment and the great commandment. In verse 39, the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. It tells us in John chapter 13. Verses 34 and 35, it says, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. And it tells us that without this love, the rest of the things we do, they'll be worthless before the Lord. So you might have been congratulating yourself that you are laboring, you are fervent, you are patient, you are persevering, you are serving, you are working. Yes, he says, I know your works. I also know that you have blessed your first love. And though you speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and you don't have love, you have become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal, not better than lifeless materials making sound. And though you have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though you have all the faith so that you can remove mountains, if you don't have love, you are nothing in the sight of God. And though you bestow your goods to feed the poor, and though you give your body to be burnt, if you don't have this love, this first love, it profits you nothing. This love we're talking about suffers long and is kind, and it envies not, and it vaunts not itself. It's not puffed up. It does not behave itself unseemly. It seeks not her own. It's not easily provoked. It does not think evil. It does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. It's the love that will bear all things for the sake of Christ. It's the love that will believe all things because of Jesus. It's the love that will hope all things and will endure all things. Now we know that faith and hope and love abide, but these three, the greatest of these is love. That's why the Lord is telling us that we need to recover, rediscover, and return to the first love that we used to have. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22, seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth, through the Spirit unto unpretending love, unhypocritical love, unfeigned love, of the brethren, it says, see to it, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently. The Lord is asking that we, is now the church Ephesus of Ephesus, you know, their time is gone. This is not our time. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, remember, and then repent and do the first works. That means repeat what you did before. Do you still love the Lord above money, above men, above material things? The Lord is saying, recollect, remember. And if you see you've lost your first love, repeat what you've done before, repent. It's your affection for Christ, your love in his presence, and your joy, and your desire for his fellowship is still as fresh, as warm, as it was in your early life, early Christian life. Remember, repent, repeat. Are you still close to the Lord? Are you as close to the Lord as you used to be? And you are closer to Christ than you are to the world? Or are you moving away from Christ and then you are getting closer and closer to the world? Remember, repent, and do the first works. Are you still sensitive to his wish and to his will? How deep and refreshing are your morning and evening devotions and your quiet time? Remember, repent, turn around, do the first works. Do you still promptly obey the voice of the Lord? Even when he convicts you, he convicts your conscience only slightly. Do you rise up immediately and say, yes, Lord, I'm sorry for that mistake I made, that omission, that commission. because of my love for you. I didn't know I could go that far. Please forgive me. Are you still sensitive to the Spirit of the Lord? As when you are the first love, remember, repent, and repeat what you did before. Do you still zealously defend the Lord and defend the glory of God? Do you still receive his word through his servants as readily, as joyfully, as you did before when you had the first love? Or have you lost the joy of fresh revelation and a fresh influence, without which your mind now is just dry? Remember how it was at that time when you were passionate and zealous and enthusiastic in the things of the Lord. Remember and repent and repeat what you did before. Are you still full of the life and love of Christ, or have you left your first love? Nevertheless, I have somewhat against you because you have left your first love. Yes, I see your activity, but there's something that pains my heart. I see your service, there's something that pains my heart. And when Christ tells you face to face that I'm not happy with you, I'm not talking about myself, I'm talking about Christ, I'm reading the message of Christ to you, I'm all right with you, I have no problem. I don't know the details of your life, but Christ knows. He says, I know your service, I know your patience, I know your perseverance, I know your labor, I know the way you are standing for sound doctrine, but nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee because you have left your first love. Wives, women, when your husband comes to you and your husband tells you, my dear, I know that you still do everything right, and the children cannot see that we don't love one another the way we used to do anymore. The children cannot see because we smile and we put on the plastic smile. We do everything. We cook all that we're cooking, and everything appears. But you and I know, wife, that the first love is not there. How do you respond, my dear sister? Do you just say, well, shrug your shoulders and walk your way? Are you going to do that to Christ today? My dear brother, when your wife tells you, calls you, my dear husband, you don't have time for me. I know you pay the school fees. I know you do everything, but there's something I see in you, my dear husband. You don't love me the way you used to love me. Do you just shrug your shoulders and walk away? Are you going to do that to Christ? Christ is saying, remember, from whence thou art fallen, why don't you repent and do the first works? I'm watching and waiting for that first love. If you don't have that first love, I'm going to come and remove the candlestick out of his place, except you repent. Now, in history, we're told the church of Smyrna is still there. Even to this present day, the church of Ephesus is no more there. It's gone. The candlestick is removed. Which will it be for you? Will your candlestick remain, or will it be removed? Let's rise up and pray. Let the prayer tonight be between you and the Lord. Meditate and think seriously about your relationship with the Lord. Remember, then repent and do the first works.